are working actually to sort of more formally institutionalize CMEI next year, we hope, in terms of developing new courses and a pathway and get some funding for some apprenticeships and internships and conferences and travel and so forth. We'll see if that works or not. But in the meantime, we are also really encouraging your own civic initiative to, make this a vibrant campus on which civic and moral education issues are addressed. So please feel free to take the initiative and propose stuff to us. Today, I'm really pleased that we have Natasha Waraku, who's an assistant professor here at the Ed School, who will be talking about what merit means. Undergraduates at elite institutions in Britain and the United States make meaning of the admissions process. Natasha is in her fourth year here, is that right? Third year here as a professor, following some time teaching at, was it LSE? University of London. I'm sorry, I was so concerned about food that I was not actually, usually like I check in with you and get the biography first. She also was a teacher before that in the schools and has a really terrific book that is out now called Balancing Acts, that compares British and American kids' construction of youth culture and academic success in hip hop, and this represents new work that we're going to hear today, which is really great. And then Phil Lee, who is a third year doctoral student here at the Ed School, will be providing some commentary and getting the discussion going. Phil is a graduate of Harvard Law School and worked in their admissions office and has a lot of and has scholarly interests in issues of admissions, affirmative action, diversity, et cetera. And our goal is that Natasha will speak for half an hour, 40 minutes or so. Phil will give 5 or 10 minutes of commentary, and then we will open it up to a really collaborative discussion. We go until 1:15, so fairly late, because our purpose is really to have a robust, thoughtful, inclusive discussion about issues. At the same time, we recognize that many people do not have an hour and 45 minutes in their day to spend on any one thing, given how scattered we are. So we do not take offense at your getting up and quietly leaving when you need to leave. I will also say that we have a sign-in sheet now as part of our attempt to institutionalize CMEI even more, if data is very good as to how much we attract people from across the university and across, you know, programs and so forth. So please fill this in, and also feel free now at any point during the talk quietly to go get yourself some food. We have a lot of it. And I'll pass it on to Natasha.
So,
Thanks for having me. I'm really delighted to be here. I'm going to be presenting findings, as Mira mentioned, on a new project that I have on students attending elite universities in the U.S. and Britain and their conceptions of diversity, multiculturalism, and inequality. This is actually my first talk in the U.S. On this project, so I'm especially excited and looking forward to the discussion afterwards. So I'll say a little bit about the project and how I came to this research, and then I'll tell you about this, the particular findings that I'm going to talk about today. So I've had a kind of long-standing interest on in race and ethnicity, inequality in education. And as I was completing the writing of my of Balancing Acts, my book that Mira mentioned, I started thinking about how inequality gets perpetuated not only by through disadvantage, but also through advantage. So So Balancing Acts is a study of children of immigrants at who are attending underperforming high schools, which is the usual way that we tend to think about inequality. But I started to think about how about kind of flipping that and thinking, well, what about thinking about how individuals with advantage can perpetuate inequality, or how they make meaning of the advantages that they do have. And in general, of racial and ethnic inequality in society. So, and then I thought about this question in with respect to elite higher education, because in a way, elite universities are places where people are really being groomed for leadership positions in society. So, these are our kind of future decision makers. interested in how institutions of higher education can and do influence their perspectives on inequality. So, and you know, people pay attention. At being at Harvard, as you know, people pay attention to the likes of Harvard, Oxford, Yale, etc., Cambridge. And I think these universities, they hold kind of symbolic meaning in the public, not just in terms of their sort of academic excellence, but also in terms of, well, the acoustics change when I come here, but also in terms of their role in status reproduction, so both in a positive way and in a negative way. They get written about a lot in the press, etc. So in the project, I'm kind of trying to understand these frames with which these emerging elites understand questions of diversity, multiculturalism, and inequality, and also how the national context as well as the university context shape that meaning making. So, and what I want to talk about today is how students in the US and Britain make meaning of the admissions process in particular. And so, and the title of my talk is What Merit Means, because what merit means is actually very different in these two national contexts, which is what I'm going to talk about. And so, you know, other researchers have shown in the United States how what merit means at elite institutions has shifted over time. So if you think back to the 1920s, Ivy League universities shifted their admissions criteria to include what they called character in order to for their own institutional goals. And in that case, in order to exclude Jewish students when they felt like there were too many Jewish students coming on campus. And the flip side, in the 1960s, started recruiting minority students because of the institutional goal of wanting to seem legitimate and fair, and like this was a fair process of admission. So, I find this devil thing very imposing, but okay. So the question really, so the question that I'm asking is, how do students who gain admission make meaning of the admissions process? And make that meaning given very public criticisms of the eliteness and inequality of the student body at places like Harvard? And how does this vary by national context? And I'll say just a little bit about the US, Britain, British comparison. So the US and Britain are similar in a lot of ways. They both see themselves as kind of multicultural societies. They tend to pride themselves in this identity. And what that actually means in terms of multiculturalism is very different in these two national contexts. But there is this sense in which we want to see ourselves as welcoming societies that are open to difference and accommodating of difference. And you can think about that in contrast to, for example, France, where you can't collect racial statistics. There's this idea of to become French is to sort of assimilate into a particular way of being French. But on the other hand, the policies that have actually emerged out of these kind of multicultural ideas in these two contexts varies considerably. And that has a lot to do with the racial history of the United States, the colonialism in Britain, who comes to these different countries, the kind of demographics. And we see kind of implications of these differences in the higher education context. So in the US, private elite universities all practice race-based affirmative action. Ivy League universities all have some form of African American studies departments or centers or institutes. Although sometimes call them, by different names, Africana studies, Afro-American studies. Some have ethnic studies, and in Britain, we don't see either of these practices. We don't see any kind of race-based or class-based affirmative action. There are no kind of significant departments of ethnic studies or race studies at the elite institutions. And we can think about, and maybe we'll talk about this later, about why those might be. But those are sort of the biggest differences in these universities. So how do they make meaning of this process given these national contexts? So my hypothesis was that students will further their own interests in making meaning of a process in which they were successful. So I won the race, and so now I want to believe that the race was legitimate and fair, and everyone had a fair shot at it, and I won because I was the best, or one of the best. And so, and we might think about this in contrast to what, say, admissions officers might say, who have other goals that they're trying to fulfill in their rhetoric around admissions in terms of seeming fair to the public, or in the UK, meeting government criteria, because all of these elite institutions in Britain are public universities. They might want to be attracting certain kinds of students in the language that they use. And we might also think about this in contrast to students who might be more critical of what the university is doing. So if there is public rhetoric around inequality and lack of access to the institution, it's not obvious that the students would ignore those criticisms, especially if we think of students tending to be quite liberal. So that's the sort of kind of key question that I want to try to address today. And I'll just tell you really briefly about the study. So we've interviewed students at undergraduates at Harvard, Brown, and Oxford. And I should say, this is not just me. I've been working with wonderful graduate students here, and actually in the UK as well, who've really been key in helping me through this project. And so we've done interviews with undergraduates both at the US. In the US, we kind of have an oversample of students of color, and in the UK, an oversample of children of immigrants. And these are all either U.S., I should say U.S. born or born or arrived before the age of six, so kind of very much grown up in the U.S. All of their memories are from the United States. And the questions that I'm going to draw on today are about admissions. So we asked them, would you say your university is a meritocracy in terms of its admissions? In what ways is it not? And then we ask a question about the underrepresentation of minority students. So in the United States, we ask about the underrepresentation of Black and Latino students and ask how students would explain that the difference between the U.S. population and the population of students at their university. We ask them if they think it's a problem and if the university should do anything about that. If it is a problem, if the university should do anything about it. And in the U.K., the question is about Black students. And then the last question that I'm going to draw on today asks students about whether we don't use the phrases affirmative action or positive discrimination that you hear in the UK, because these are very loaded phrases. So we just ask, should the university consider race or ethnicity when making admissions decisions? And then we ask the question about class as well, with the same question about class. In the US, we ask about athletic ability and a legacy status, so whether the parents are alumni. And then a question about whether someone has gone to a private or a public high school. And this is the criteria by which you often hear. It seems like every year when the admission statistics comes out, that the Guardian has an article, a scathing article about Oxford and Cambridge and how there are what they call state school graduates are very underrepresented in the students who are going to those universities. So before I tell you what students in the study said, I'd like to for us to just get a sense of the perspectives in this room. So that's what your clickers are for. So I think, Bill, maybe you can help me out in here, that they have to get the number, right? So what you want to do with your clicker is type, is it star and then the number, Phil? 70?
Channel, the number, and then channel, go. Go, the number, then go again.
The number is 70. That's what it says on here. 70.
Anyone need a clicker?
Yep.
Just type 70 or put channel?
Channel, 70, channel.
Yeah, 70.
Go or channel. Depends on the one.
Go 70.
Go again.
Natasha, while people are here,
yes.
I have a quick clarifying question.
Yeah.
Are the 52 UK born with UK parents, are they white, or some of them potentially, say, Pakistani or other origin?
No, they're all white.
Okay,
yeah.
And then when you use the term black with the UK students,
yeah,
do they mentally, is that Afro-Caribbean and subcontinent? Is that
mm-hmm.
sort of the implication,
no.
or it's just
that? Yeah, the implication right now in the UK is that it's mostly Afro-Caribbean, African as well, but mostly Afro-Caribbean.
Okay.
So should elite university admissions consider attributes other than academic skills and potential in their decisions? Click, so you just say one. Oh, sorry, the polling is open. Click one for yes and two for no. It's pretty straightforward.
have academic potential?
That's a good question. Whatever you think it means. I don't want to spend too much time on that. That's the kind of phrase that you'll hear, academic potential. The potential to do well in your subject, or
yeah,
do well academically.
Should I be being good at being a researcher or being good at getting a job? And
I would say being good at getting A's in college. Okay, so I'm going to close the poll, and then, okay. So most people say yes. Not everyone, but most people say yes. So this is kind of the key difference that we're going to see between the U.S. and Britain, where students are pretty clear that if we were in Britain today, I think that might be flipped, right? So most students say that these are the main criteria. That's what it should be. Whereas in the United States, it's a much more kind of expansive view of on what should be considered. And obviously, we're in the United States. So that's the first question. Second, underrepresented ethnic and racial minorities should get special consideration in university admissions in order to increase racial diversity on campus. About 80% of you agree, about less than 20% disagree. And if you look at the United States, we see similar strong agreement among the students in this study. So I forgot to mention, we did a short survey, a kind of pre-interview survey of students, which this data comes from, in both countries. So you see in the U.S. about, turning point doesn't let me combine these categories, about two-thirds of U.S. students agree with this statement. In contrast, very few U.K. students agree with this, right? Just over 10%. Now, if we switch the, reason now. So underrepresented ethnic and racial minorities should get special consideration in university admissions because they've experienced disadvantage in their lives. Two-thirds of you, now a little less agreement, but still coming down on the side of agreement. And you see that you actually, again, American that many of you are, not all of you, we see a similar trend among the U.S. students, where the majority agree, but slightly less agree with the argument about disadvantage versus the argument of diversity on campus. Now, but you see the direction goes in the responses go in the other direction in the UK now. So students are more likely, still generally disagree with this, but are more likely to agree with this idea that students who experience disadvantage should have some kind of special consideration in admissions. Okay. So, and one last question, working class and poor students should get special consideration in university admissions because they've experienced disadvantage of their lives. Now we see a very strong agreement among all of you. Actually, in the U.S. respondents, we see strong agreement. But if we compare them to the U.K., again, we see much more agreement. Again, because if we think of the U.S. as a predominantly race-based society, we think of ourselves as a racialized society. The U.K. tends to think of itself as a class-based society. So more agreement in this case, but still less than half. So even if we think about class, we see less than half of students wanting to sort of consider any kind of class disadvantage in admissions to the university. So that gives you kind of an overview of what the students said. And now I'm going to kind of read you the more interesting version of the findings, which is what students actually said in their interviews.
So what did we find? I'm going to run through kind of the summary. I'll give you the bottom line, and then I'll go back. So students generally defended the admissions process to their respective campuses. And again, you know, I mentioned that earlier. It's not such a surprise. And much of the language that they use really mirrors the administrators from their respective universities. And there is this kind of, seems to be this, what I didn't expect, but this very seamless kind of parallel between the admissions who's making admissions decisions and what the students are saying. Perhaps one might think puzzling or disturbing somehow, but interesting at least, the very least. So in the US, students talk about making the most of the opportunities that one had available in high school, and also the importance of campus diversity. While in Britain, I was a math major, so I like little equations. There's this, you know, I get the sense of that there's kind of this equation of one has to have ability, and you know, whatever, wherever that comes from, one might think of that as innate or whatever. But that ability has to be cultivated, and the way that that ability gets cultivated is in certain tends to be in certain kinds of schools, perhaps certain kinds of families, and those together lead to one's potential. So if you cultivate, if you have this ability, you cultivate it, you develop a potential to succeed at Oxford, and that's what should determine whether or not you are admitted to the university. So that's the sort of the main finding. And so making the most of opportunities, so I'm gonna talk about the United States and then I'll go to talk about Britain. So making the most of opportunities available. So I'll just read you two quotes from students in the United States. The first is a white student at Harvard, and we asked, this is in response to the question, should there be affirmative action by school type in this question? And the student says, "What needs to be considered in your admissions is how you've made the most of the opportunities that you've had. And in that sense, if you go to a private school that's maybe like really rich and like a really great education and like all these good things, and then you have somebody who went to a public school that maybe didn't have as much money, but they took huge full advantage of the opportunities that they had there, and they really milked it for all it's worth, and that person should definitely, like if the person from the private school wasn't like that, the person from the public school should get it." And this is a different quote from a student of color at Brown, who again contrasts two different kinds of students, a student who grows up in disadvantage from an underperforming school and a student who goes to a better, stronger high school. And the student says, it talks about someone who, quote unquote, came with stories and a background and a fight to get here. And she says, "I think they, meaning the admissions office, try and get people who've done well academically, but I don't think that's the main priority. So it depends how you evaluate merit. And to me, it's far more, you know, a story and a fight and someone's character is of greater merit than their academic performance." So she's talking very explicitly about character as opposed to academic performance. And you can see she has a kind of flexible notion of what merit means in that quote. And I should say, overall, I'm not going to talk about the differences between Harvard and Brown today because the students were very similar. You might think, you know, these are very similar kinds of institutions, Harvard and Brown. They're similar location, Ivy League institutions, similar admissions rates on a whole host of measures. Although we know that Brown has this kind of much more liberal left kind of reputation. But students were very similar in their responses. So they were different in other ways, but in terms of admissions, I won't be sort of talking about those differences because I didn't really see those. So that's making the most of opportunities available. Second, everyone has a hook. And together, this cohort makes a diverse group that leads to more learning. So there's a sense in which you need some special something. You know, the admissions rates at places like Harvard and Brown today are under 10%. It's incredibly competitive. This is a white student at Brown who says that, we asked her, is Brown a meritocracy in admissions? And the student says, "I think Brown is very much a meritocracy, but it's a specific kind of meritocracy. It's less about pure merit, I think, and more about merit in addition to uniqueness and some diverse factor. Everyone I've met here has at least one thing that makes them who they are, and very rarely is it actually like they were a science fair winner. The example I talk about is my friend. He spends 2 or 3 hours every single night of his life playing piano in the music hall. He's gifted as a composer, as a pianist. To me, that's just one of the many people that have one unique thing that makes them who they are, on top of good grades, good SAT scores, whatever. Now, when we think about everyone having a hook that kind of gets them into the university, one of the hooks that students actually talk about is race, so and being an underrepresented minority. So when, in response to the question, should the university consider race or ethnicity, this is what one student says. This is a white student at Harvard. The student said, ethnic diversity adds as much to the class as somebody who's a world-class piano player. It's a different student, but the piano theme is continuing. And it's just a different sort of like diversity to add. So diversity comes, becomes this part of, you know, creating this diverse cohort. We all have our special talents, something to offer. And what some students have to offer is their background. Others have to offer a skill. And we can think about how this might be problematic for the student body. And that was a common perspective. So flexible notions of merit, and I alluded to that earlier. I'll just read you one quote from a white student at Brown. And actually, this is a question that I didn't mention earlier. One of the questions we ask is, does diversity create any problems for the university or university life? So it's a question on diversity. And the student says, I think before I applied, I thought I didn't like the fact that it's really easy for like recruited athletes. I had issues with that. Now that I'm here, I don't have those issues. Because I see, like, I love going to the football games. It's fun. It's part of the student life. The things they do for the campus are wonderful. I used to think that sort of the idea of diversity, like having these, you know, having athletes who are quote unquote less qualified, I no longer view them as less qualified. I view them as qualified in a different way. So again, very explicitly talking about a different kind of qualification. The other interesting thing to me about this quote is that the students ask about diversity and perhaps is hedging the question a little bit by talking about athletes, because there's a lot of discomfort around talking about race and this fear of kind of seeming sounding racist, etc. But in any case, the student responds to the diversity question by talking about athletes. Now, you can see that this, the way the students are talking about this kind of creating this cohort is about racial diversity for its impact on me. So racial diversity is great because it creates this diversity, and then I have a better educational experience as a result, so I think it's a good thing. So in response to the question about whether race should be considered, this is a student at Brown, says, I didn't think so before I got here, and I think so now, because I definitely think that they bring that different groups of people, I had a better experience because they provided me with insight that I otherwise wouldn't have. So two things to think about here. One is that, again, this is about, you know, it's about me and what and how I benefit. But also we can see that in some of these, what's the university influence, right? So I thought something, I came to college, I changed my perspective because of my experiences in class, you know, going to football games, perhaps in conversation with some of my peers, and this is what I think now. And so then the implication of this is that the underrepresentation of racial minorities is not a problem if the campus is already diverse. So the question that we asked in the United States is that 15% of students at both Harvard and Brown, although that's gone up at Brown I think this year, are Black or Latino, but 25% of the United States is that, and then the question is that a problem? And this is an Asian American student at Brown, and she says, I think morally and philosophically on an abstract level, it's a problem. But when I'm sitting in class, I don't feel it. I don't feel the lack of diversity when I'm sitting there. I don't feel surrounded by white people. I also don't feel that our community is lacking in any way. So she's sort of looking around and saying, you know what, Brown is not the place that it was 50 years ago. My classes are diverse. I don't feel like I'm in the minority in the same kind of way. It's not a problem because we do have, because there's a quorum of Black and Latino students in particular on campus. And, you know, we can think about alternatives to this kind of diversity argument for higher education. The one that I put on the polling slide, disadvantage in one's life, ones that I've heard in the past, creating a minority elite, reparations even. And so it's not sort of the obvious kind of justification or explanation that we would necessarily assume that people would give, but it's definitely the most prevalent and almost the only one that we heard from students in the United States. However, I think it's also a less compelling argument than perhaps some of these other ones, and it doesn't really take into consideration some of the historical reasons why affirmative action developed in the first place in the United States. And we can talk about that in the discussion. So the American students also had a very pragmatic approach, and we saw that most, I was kind of surprised about the support for legacy admits. I didn't expect this. But so, you know, we asked students about, you know, should whether your parents are alums of this university be a consideration. And there was kind of understood ambivalence, but, you know, a lot of students said, well, this student is a student of color at Harvard said, I'd like to say no, but practically speaking, I suppose it's easier to raise money for your alumni if, and then she laughs, it's clear that you have a better chance of getting your kid in. And the interesting thing was that a lot of students of color actually supported legacy admits and said very bluntly that, well, basically, now that I'm here, I want my children to be able to go here. So, yes. So, which, again, came as a surprise to me. Now, all right, and so I talked about the university influences. So what do the admissions office say? As I mentioned earlier, there was this kind of seamless parallel between what students said and what their admissions officers said. So I read you something from the Brown admissions website. And they say, our admission demands that we discover how individual applicants would contribute to and benefit from the lively academic, social, and extracurricular activity at Brown. So there's the kind of non-academic criteria, right? It's about the social and extracurricular as well. We have the humbling luxury of choosing candidates who stand out for special abilities, accomplishments, energy for learning, thoughtfulness, perspective, there's the diversity argument, I think, and many other qualities. It is the mixture of individuals with different strengths and backgrounds, that makes for the most dynamic and productive undergraduate community. Community, so the last word is, again, community, right? It's about this diverse cohort. And, you know, the Harvard Dean of Admissions, Dean Fitzsimmons, wrote this article about admissions in the New York Times a few years ago. And in it he says, while we value objective criteria, we apply a more expansive view of excellence. There's the kind of flexible notion of excellence. Test scores and grades offer some indication of students' academic promise and achievement, but we also scrutinize applications for extracurricular distinction. Again, you can see some of the words are even the same in these two, and personal qualities. Students' intellectual imagination, strength of character, there's that kind of moral character component, and their ability to exercise good judgment. These are critical factors in the admissions process. We believe a diversity of backgrounds, academic interests, extracurricular talents, and career goals among students who live and learn together affects the quality of education in the same manner as a great faculty or material resources. So, to me, kind of shocking seamlessness between these two. So, however, and I alluded to this as I was sort of going through these slides, the process leads to students evaluating each other's worthiness on campus. And this was often, and most commonly, a positive assessment. So students would say things like, well, you know what, I've never met anyone who doesn't deserve to be here. But what does that say? That says that they're scrutinizing that they're wondering, is there anyone here, given this flexibility, is there anyone here who really shouldn't be here? And this is one example in which a student had a kind of negative assessment. So we asked the student, this is a Asian American student at Brown. Are there ways in which you think Brown is not a meritocracy for admission? So we say, in what ways is it, in what ways is it not? And the student says, I think athletics is always a point of contention. It was really sad. I was in my sociology class and some kid asked, we were talking about a paper that was due, and this is so sad that I thought this, but he said, you don't want us to have to use MLA or nothing like that. And then he asked a couple more questions. And the first thing that popped in my head was, oh, he must be an athlete. And that happens a lot. I think the other interesting thing about this quote is the kind of use of the double negative there. It's unclear whether she's signaling a kind of class or race difference. I don't know. But definitely, she's looking at her peers. She thinks someone asks a stupid question, and then she assumes that they are in one of these categories that doesn't, quote unquote, deserve to be here. So there is this kind of evaluation that goes on. Second, and I think more significantly, is I think that leads to some racial resentment. So I'll read you a quote from a white student at Harvard who said, when I was applying to college, I was really frustrated with I'm not sure how much weight was actually put on it, but when filling out college applications and answering these questions so many times about my ethnic background and talking and it really frustrated me that I Notice all the likes and the ums, and you know, they start to get very uncomfortable, right? It really frustrated me that I felt like I would be more likely to get into a school if I was a minority. So no, you can see the discomfort in his words, and we definitely see this in quotes like this in the United States. But also keep in mind that this student is a student that got into Harvard. So this is a student who got into Harvard and is still feeling like, well, still kind of has that sense of, you know, I somehow may have been disadvantaged. And just imagine if he didn't get in, right? As you know, the 90-something percentage of students who don't get in and what they might be feeling if they sort of have these understandings of the criteria of admission. So it creates this kind of racial resentment, and I think related to that, and I think this is a larger issue that we find in the project, is the sense of not being able to talk about these things and not being able to speak sort of openly and honestly about race and on campus. So that's the U.S. And Britain. The British section is going to be shorter because it's much simpler. So students said, here's a quote from a student, Oxford has a very clear stated aim, and that is to maintain its position in an intellectual society. Okay, and that's that. End of story. So the students were very clear in what they believed. It was very simple. It was very neat. Standard simple criteria and based on individuals. So one student said, I think the admission system at the moment is good in the sense that it accepts people purely on the basis of academic ability. So notice the word pure. I'll just tell you a little bit about admissions to Oxford. The kind of initial criteria that you have to, there are national exams at the end of the equivalent of 12th grade in the US. You have to have at least, for most subjects, you have to have at least 3 A's on in subjects related to what you're wanting to study. And that is sort of the baseline. Some subjects, it's 2 A's and an A star, which is like a plus. Some it's 2 A's and a B. But anyway, that's sort of roughly the criteria. So then if you have that, you apply, and then you get interviewed. And the interviews are, the admissions happens through their, what they call the colleges. So you might be familiar with Harvard College, which is kind of structured on the Oxford model, but Oxford is much more decentralized. So admissions decisions are made by the college and by people in your subject. So you're gonna be interviewed by, so you go to college, to university to study your particular subject. You're gonna be interviewed by someone who teaches that subject. So someone who might be your tutor. When you get there, you know, because they have these kind of 2-on-1 or 3-on-1 or 1-on-1 tutorials. So academic staff are interviewing them. So, sorry, that's a little digression. So here, I'll read you a quote from a student in the UK who he asked the question about meritocracy, and the student says, yeah, I mean, basically the interviews are obviously the main part of the admissions process, and I think they're there to see who would be the best at the subject. And it's obviously in the professor's or the admissions tutor's interest to let the best people in, best again, you know, how they define best, because then they'll get the best marks, best grades, and generally be the most interesting to teach. So yeah, I think it's a meritocracy. And then we ask the same student, in what ways is it not? And the student says, well, I suppose it depends on what you define as merit, because obviously it's a very narrow form of meritocracy, because it's just about who'll do best in the subject. Whereas there are obviously other forms of merit, like moral merits, sporting ability, whatever, which just don't get considered at all. So notice the moral merits in contrast to the student in the US who talks about character and the importance of character in admissions. The Oxford students had a kind of what I call a universalist approach. And the student says, well, you know, we ask the questions about whether the university should consider race, class, et cetera, in admissions. And one student said, it's very difficult because positive discrimination, well, yeah, but in a way it's still discrimination, isn't it? Ultimately, we should just all be blank faces. We should just all be admitted totally on merit, and it wouldn't be fair to try to alter the levels of the application. So, you know, the words fair, pure, blank face, a sea of blank faces, there's this kind of ideal that we are coming here on equal footing, and it's just there's one thing that we're looking at, and that's what's fair. Here's another student who was a state school grad, what we call a public school graduate, and who went to a school that was actually a low performing school in Britain. And this student says, I think with Oxford, it's such an elite institution that I think something like positive discrimination that detracts from the application process. I think it should be very much based on merit rather than background. I personally, if I knew that I had been positively discriminated for being from a state comprehensive school, I knew that when I came here, I think when I came here, I would find a lot more difficult because I'd feel that I hadn't earned my place to be here. So there's a sense, even among students who are not coming from non-traditional backgrounds, that the institution is what it is, and if you're not part of that culture, then you need to do your best to fit in, and if you don't fit in, then you shouldn't be here. So it's kind of thinking the institution much more kind of static kind of view of the institution. And cultivation, there is a sense that poor education causes underrepresentation, and I talked about this earlier. So when I asked how do you explain the underrepresentation of black students, one student said, you get to Oxford as a result of your education, really. No matter how naturally brilliant you are, you have to be well educated. And as I said earlier, the wealth distribution in society means that white people have more access to the best education, even in the state sector. The state schools are of a lower quality, in my belief, in areas of greater ethnic density. Another student said, in terms of grades, some schools are just better at getting good grades than others. If you're just not rich enough to get sent to one of those really good schools where they give you loads and loads of work, there are a lot of people who could be here, but they just can't because they haven't been trained well enough. So again, there's a sense that, and then when students were asked, should the university do something about this, the vast majority of students said, no, that's not the university's responsibility, that's not really fair, we need to fix the K-12 system, and that really sucks, but that's it's a completely different issue. So intelligence plus cultivation equals potential. So what are the costs and benefits of this perspective? So there was a kind of clear, simple logic to what the British student said. You know, I didn't hear a lot of the same hemming ums and ahs and likes and wells and long pauses in the transcripts. I didn't hear the same kinds of racial resentment expressed. However, and this is quite a big however, but there weren't really solutions to change the status quo or to increase opportunities for the Oxford experience, and I think this is very important. So there's a literature in the United States on what's called kind of new racism, which talks about how individuals in the United States can support racial equality and multiculturalism more broadly speaking, but when asked about particular policies to move toward racial equality or multiculturalism, they sort of back away and don't support that. There's a lot of kind of survey data that looks at these kind of patterns. And I think that this kind of, these students' perspectives kind of resonate with what we see in the United States to some extent in this kind of new racism literature. So in a way, the students kind of saying that yes, this is a problem, but no, we shouldn't do anything about it, is kind of in those same lines. And so, now what does the university have to say? Now again, the Oxford system is much more decentralized than the United States, but I'll just read you from the admissions website. So the website says, the interview is designed to assess your academic abilities and most importantly, your academic potential beyond your written record. The interview allows admissions tutors to evaluate your understanding of an aptitude for your subject and to give you the opportunity to explain why you're committed to studying it. And I had the opportunity to interview the director of undergraduate admissions at Oxford this summer, and he said, we're taking students who really only need to be good at mathematics. This is obviously for the math degree. It doesn't really matter whether they've got any social skills or have any interest in liberal arts or humanities or whatever, as long as they're good at they're good mathematicians. He was very clear, and the things that he said again really resonated with what I heard students saying in the interviews with interviews at Oxford. So
well, those masters were a bit low on social skills.
They like people like that. Like themselves. Well, I mean, this is an interesting thing about the Oxford system as well, if you think about the role of cultural capital. If these are people you know you're gonna be teaching next year, you want people that you like and that you connect with, right? And if you think about, what's that?
No, that's an assumption. That's quite a US assumption. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, they want people who are smart and who can do the damn subject. They don't care if they like them.
Yeah.
They really don't.
Okay.
In the humanities, you get a slightly different story. I think they do go a lot by, can I teach this person? Can I have a conversation with them?
but what it means to be teachable, I think, can be can kind of be culturally informed as well.
Sure.
And how we evaluate whether someone is teachable, or you know, evaluate this idea of potential. I think.
I really mean within the tutorial context. That's the major.
Or I mean, I think also, how does one signal that one is teachable, right? Or what are the kind of criteria by which we evaluate what it means to be teachable? I haven't sat in on
these. That's part of the reason why they have these interview procedures. They try to put the student in the very context in which they're supposedly be going to be learning. So in contrast to here, none of these decisions are made by administrators.
Right. That's right.
It's really an important distinction.
Yeah. That's right.
Yes.
Yeah.
So uh-huh. that means that an individual like me over there wouldn't have a prayer.
I don't know that you wouldn't have a prayer.
Based on that process, I wouldn't have a prayer. I wouldn't have a chance to be here at Harvard with the potential that I have. And now that I have my midterms, you know, done already, and I see the grades, I said, yeah, they made a wise choice.
Good for you.
I'm sure you would have gotten that message across in the
news. I have a feeling you would have that. Okay. Maybe I should just, in the interest of time, I'll skip this. This is sort of just a summation. So, you know, different kind of goals of admissions that students are expressing. In part, as Paul was alluding to, there are different kind of learning, ways of learning at these institutions, and why or why not affirmative action or positive discrimination. In the United States, it's about diversity. In Britain, it violates merit. The United States, I would argue, the students tend to have a more practical approach, whereas the British students have a more universalist approach. And there are problems with both. So in the United States, students are evaluating each other. There's racial resentment. In the UK, there's a lack of support for mechanisms to change the status quo. So, you know, obviously, historical reasons lead to these very different regimes. There's a lot of things going on in terms of the racial content landscape, but also how the teaching happens at these elite institutions. Social movements and public versus private, but these are sort of the kind of pluses and minuses of
these. Can I just add one qualifier to the bottom right box?
I
sort of disagree with that because I think there's a lot of anxiety in Oxford colleges about the lack of representation of not certain racial groups but social class, and so you will find tutors and students alike sometimes collaborating on initiatives to outreach. So for example, the college I worked at, students would often go back to the communities from which they had come and go to try to persuade students to apply to Oxford. Because part of the problem is that many students in less high functioning schools decide for themselves that there's absolutely no point in them applying to Oxford because they want to get in, and Oxford is constantly trying to battle with that, and to some extent, misperception.
So
I'm saying there is some support for, but I agree it's not to change Oxford into, as it were, a coherent set of diverse students. It's to make it more representative,
right?
But especially with respect to social class.
Yeah. So I think there are two differences between these two that I think maybe are highlighted in what you said, Paul. One is that there's a race versus class question, right? But I think even with class, and I think the U.S. does a good job of class diversity because I think that's less of a focus. And some of the recent writing has started to highlight that, the fact that this issue of working class students. The mechanism for that, so if you even replace race with class in the U.S. model, it's still very different, right? Because the idea is that in the U.K. you go out and you encourage students to apply, right? Now, if you happen to be that student, that student who manages to get 3 A's in spite of a very low quality education, in spite of working very hard and making the most of what you have, you still don't get those 3 A's because you just haven't had those opportunities, you're not going to get in, right? So that's the difference. Whereas in the U.S., I think there is some sense that you did everything you could, you took full advantage, and therefore you've shown in other ways that you have potential and that you. Now that's starting to change a little bit. The other softening some of the criteria, and with the new fees, the higher fees that are being charged, the universities are being asked by the central government to show that they're wide, somehow widening access. So I think this is starting to kind of move at the seams a little bit. But I think that what you do with that is still kind of different in these two contexts, if that makes sense. Yeah.
Is this a question time?
Sure. I mean, yeah, go ahead. No, please.
So I guess there are two things. They're both, and you've touched on different cultural frameworks, because it's two different cultures.
Yeah.
But there are also different legal frameworks.
Yeah.
I mean, in the UK, it's not legal to discriminate on the basis of class or race. Universities cannot legally do it. And so it doesn't make much sense to ask students to expect for them to say that they should be able to legally allow them.
Yeah.
But in addition to that, I think there is the cultural assumption that the redistributive aspect of education, whereby some sort of egalitarianism is achieved, will be completed by the end of the state education. Some of the quotes that you said suggested that. But I don't think saying, as one of your students said, Oxford, for example, is not a place where redistributive educational policies should be enacted, but they should be enacted in the state sector, and there's a real problem there.
Yeah.
It's the same as saying there shouldn't be anything to change the status quo. I think that it's rather saying the locus of the problem is not here at the university, which has a specific narrow focus. It's elsewhere.
Yeah. So, and that should be the status quo at the university in particular, not in the country. Absolutely,
yes.
I take that point. And so, but in terms of that, I looked at Phil because I've been having this conversation with him about the legal status. You know, I taught this course on multiculturalism in higher education in these two countries last semester, and I started thinking, and I realized I don't quite know the legal context in the UK. So there is racial equality legislation in the UK that says that you can, that what they call positive action is allowed, which is kind of like what Paul was describing, but positive discrimination is not allowed, which might perhaps be the equivalent of the U.S. affirmative action. Now, you know, the U.S. also has legislation that says that racial discrimination is not allowed. It doesn't talk specifically about affirmative action, but I think the point here is that it's unclear, and I'm not suggesting that there should be, you know, that the UK, I'm not certainly not suggesting that the UK should adopt American style affirmative action by any means. I think it's a very different context. You know, you need British solutions for British issues, but that I think the legal question is, the jury is still out because it hasn't really been tested in court. You know, the way that we figured out what's legal and what's not legal is a very fine line in the United States. You know, not quotas, but holistic admissions, and you know, there have been a series of U.S. Supreme Court cases that have really determined that have interpreted the law. You haven't had that in the UK, so you know, this piece of legislation says that. But I think the jury is still out about whether, you know, what would happen if this were kind of some university instituted this one of these practices and then it got contested in court. So I'm not sure. I'm not a legal scholar, but. But I think the point is that it's been interpreted in that way probably because of the cultural context, right? And it's been challenged, on the flip side, it's been challenged in the U.S. because of the United States cultural context, right? So.
Well, then there's also,
I'm going to sort of exercise chair role from the floor because I want to make sure Natasha gets a chance to finish and that we get a chance to hear from Phil, and then we'll go back.
Okay. So I'll just be really quick to conclude, and I think I've said some of these points before. So. The findings show that students have very different definitions of merit and worthiness in admissions, and most students' definitions resonate with their respective admissions gatekeepers. This legitimates their own success. And this framing of their meaning making is very much contextual and very much shaped by university rhetoric. And admissions decision makers should keep in mind how their practices and discourses affect student interactions, and we saw this especially in the United States, perceptions, and more broadly speaking, social inequality. So where do these differences stem from? And this is my musings, my hypothesis, my hypothesizing. I think part of it, and there's some evidence for this, that has to do with their campus experiences and the culture on campus. In the U.S., Mitchell Stevens has written this great book about admissions to selective universities, and he talks about the ways in which college counselors, admissions meetings, and et cetera, and in this sort of recruitment and this extremely competitive environment leads to information flows that lead to students in the U.S. having a particular perspective that really matches what the what these offices are saying, and in contrast to the U.K. And then the legal considerations of the universities. And what do they suggest for questions on inequality and diversity? So emerging elites defend their elite status, whether new or old elites. So in this question, again, students who were, you know, first-generation college students or students of color there were some differences, but not so different from students coming from more traditional backgrounds at these universities. The admissions rhetoric impacts student views and perceptions and notions of fairness. And I think the last thing is that universities can play a role in shaping student perspectives on this kind of very charged issue. So if we think about this in the context of kind of future leaders on diversity and social change, I think this is important sort of to think about the way that their views are developing over the college years. So I'll turn it over to Phil.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening.
Thank you, Mira and Natasha, for inviting me to be the discussant. I'm going to just jump right into it. So I'd like to introduce a historical and legal lens into Natasha's research and framework. So hopefully it will elucidate some things that are going on in the U.S., and it's going to lead to further questions in terms of the legal and historical framework as it elucidates the British response in terms of the responses that Natasha got through her study. My main hypothesis, and I'll be brief, I'm going to talk about 7 minutes, is that American students are the legatees of a legal and admissions system in which race is embedded right in the fabric of these institutions. I'll give you some historical markers to illustrate my point. The first Immigration and Naturalization Act in this country was passed by Congress in 1790. In order to be a naturalized citizen in 1790, there was a whiteness requirement. If you're born outside the United States and you want to be a naturalized U.S. citizen, you had to be white. Okay? I teach this in my law classes. I ask my class, my students, what year do you think this whiteness requirement was taken out of federal law? What year? People will guess. They say 1865, the end of the Civil War, right? That's a fair guess, right? With the end of slavery, anti-slavery amendments, 13th, 14th, 15th Amendments, that is a fair guess. Not even close. It was 1952, right? In 1866, in response to the Civil War and anti-slavery amendments, Congress enacted an exception to the whiteness requirement. People of African descent could be naturalized, right? But if you look at the testimony in Congress, but that means, but if we move away from the whiteness requirement and not make this carve out for people of African descent, that means Asians and South Americans, right? And a lot of other darker skinned people could be naturalized. That's gonna ruin the fabric of society, right? These aren't closed door discussions. Right, this is in the congressional record, right? So race is always already there. Yeah, during the 1920s, there were a series of court challenges, right? So there were people saying, I understand that there's a whiteness requirement for me to become a naturalized U.S. citizen, but if you look at my upbringing, I was educated at American institution, I'm Christian, my friends, I have lots of white friends, so even though I'm Japanese, right, even though I'm Turkish, even though I'm Mexican, even though I'm Armenian, I should be considered white under the law and given the privileges of a naturalized U.S. citizen, right? The cases that are most famous that reached the U.S. Supreme Court in 1922, U.S. versus Ozawa, right? Takao Ozawa, 1922, he makes this very argument. I understand in 1790 you articulated the whiteness requirement, and I technically can't be a citizen under the law, but let me tell you about my background. I was educated at Berkeley. I'm fully assimilated, I have perfect English, right? So culturally, I am white, right? Justice Sutherland says, no way, right? According to the racial scientists at the time, you're not, right? Only Caucasians can be white. 3 months later, there's a Sikh, right? A South Asian person named Thind sues in the same court before the same judge. Racial scientists at the time say, South Asians are actually Caucasian. Right. If you trace the lineage of our cultural anthropologists, they would say that South Asians are placed in this category. What does Justice Sutherland rule 3 months later? Even though I said 3 months ago, that you have to be Caucasian to be white. Everyone knows that Indian people are not white. Citizenship denied, right? First historical marker that supports my proposition that race is embedded in our legal history, right? Second historical marker, 1789, US Constitution was ratified. This is a pro-slavery constitution. Just to give you, I won't go into detail, but Article 1, Section 2, the three-fifths clause, right? Slavery is allowed until 1808, as provided by Article 1, Section 9. The fugitive slave laws should be enforced, Article 4, Section 2. In this language, slavery is not mentioned, right? African, Africa is not mentioned, right? They use sort of vague language, such other persons. They define it as such. They say free persons, Indians not taxed, and such other persons, right? So in terms of some of this discomfort in the US where people are being interviewed about racial issues, I think it's a tension, because I understand the founders of the Constitution when they didn't put these labels, these titles right in the Constitution, because there's a contradiction with the Declaration of Independence, where all men, or I would say people, are created equal, right? And we have a pro-slavery constitution, right? Which leads to the Civil War in this country, right? 1861 to 1865, 618,000 Americans killed in the bloodiest war in American history over the issue of slavery, right? In the context of 250 years of slavery, 100 plus years of Jim and Jane Crow, we have the Civil Rights Movement in the 1960s. It took that long, right, to gain some, I guess, critical mass and power for these groups in the margins to push back. So in the 1960s, we have a Civil Rights Movement, right? That spawned student activism, which is something I study as well, where students for the first time are saying, these negative labels you're putting on me in terms of racial identity, I'm transforming these and turning them into something positive, right? Let me stop there and talk about the history of admissions very briefly, right? I have 3 minutes. History of admissions. So I'm gonna start in around 1920s, right? So the holistic admissions process that we know today, Natasha mentioned character a number of times, something that the US students refer to in a positive sense, that was instituted to limit the number of Jewish students attending the most elite institutions, right? In 1919, according to James Carabell in the book, The Chosen, Columbia opened up the first admissions office, creating a holistic admissions process, right? So they evaluated character, family pictures, last names. Again, my point is race, distinction, exclusion, all part and parcel of what it means to be in America, right? In the 1960s, let me connect it with what I said before. We have a civil rights movement, we have the black power movement, black is beautiful, yellow, brown, red power movements, right? Where it becomes a positive identity, right? This transforms a lot of the decision making. So before it was about exclusion, but using the same framework that was used to exclude Jewish students in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, 50s, right? We're using that same discretionary model to include people, right? Natasha mentioned the court cases. I'll just briefly summarize them. Bakke, 1978. White male student denied to the University of Davis Medical School. He was saying, university should not have the discretion to use race as a plus factor, right? He lost, as we know. 2003, same model was challenged, right? The character, the holistic review, the discretion admissions offices have in this country to look at race, and it was affirmed. Justice Sandra Day O'Connor in 2003 said, race-conscious admissions is a compelling government interest because of the educational benefits. I would argue there's one additional holding. Right? It wasn't just the educational benefit. She said there's a symbolic value to have a diverse professional class because it gives legitimacy to the professions. Right? So this is in 10 minutes, not 7 minutes. In 10 minutes, this is some historical and legal context to explain the differences in what the respondents in the US said versus Britain. Here's my question. I have no answer for this. And maybe I'll write a paper next year. Let's take Britain. That's a country with a history of slavery, right? Slave trade was in full force in Britain. This is a country with racial minorities, and this is a country with racial stratification, right? In terms of the legal historical difference, what happened? So we have such weak race consciousness in this country. I'm not saying it's a good or bad thing, I'm just saying it's different, right? But if you could use the analysis that I'm trying to develop for the American context, what was the difference in Britain, right? I have no idea. Thank you.
Which creates this dynamic that's played out in such a way in America that maybe hasn't in Britain, because, I mean, Britain's so old, but I wouldn't imagine that they would say they weren't founded to be a place where you could be religiously free, to break from the constraints of some other colonizing entity. Whereas that is why there's a big rock that's all about we are trying to be as free as possible. We're breaking away from any kind of constraint, from any kind of exclusion. And so you put that up against, written in the blood, in the cobblestones, these rules that are meant to do the exact thing that they said that we're creating this country to not do. And it's just a mind, like, their mind, people's minds get blown, and there's a lot of likes and ums, and people look at people of color in this country as the personification of that contradiction. Like, you see a black person at Harvard, you see an Asian American student at Brown, and they are the manifestation of that contradiction. And so the sort of, what do you call it, the racial resentment, they live it.
Applications making this sort of decision. It's more, I think, graduate schools are more akin toward how the Oxbridge model is, where there is a closer interview perspective, because this is a person the professor is considering whether or not I'm going to work with them. And so there is a little bit more closer. So again, the background is with the university, with U.S. universities, there's this objective about wanting to create a well-rounded individual. If you just take a look at just Harvard, for instance, in their undergraduate requirements, they have to take history, they have to take English,
yeah,
math, some quantitative analysis. Whereas in Oxbridge, a chemistry major never has to worry about reading code, never has to worry about reading reading any literature. It's just chemistry.
Yeah.
The well-roundedness came in their their K through in their upbringing, and I met chemist majors that can quote Foucault, and it's quite impressive. They have a good K through 12 background.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's just a philosophical difference, whereas U.S., they're interested in trying to create this well-rounded individual, that can participate in the community. Again, in the book mentioned The Chosen,
yeah,
the idea is shifting toward about when they try to create these admissions, they're trying to create, presumption is when the admissions officers are trying to select, they're trying to form a class, and this is only for the private schools. It doesn't apply to places, public schools like Berkeley or Michigan. But private schools like Harvard or Yale, they're trying to create a class, a graduating class, and sort of, and whatever that is, some sort of personality, which is quite different from what the Oxbridge model. It's just, can the person actually do the work? Do they if they're reading the literature, are they well read? If they're reading mathematics, can they actually, are they competent enough to do the problems?
Yeah.
And they're not worried about, you know, the sort of well-roundedness,
yeah,
versus where there is a certain aim for diversity. So I'm thinking there's a difference in the,
yeah,
philosophical approaches to it.
No, absolutely. I mean, the all of these kind of more national differences aside, the educational model is very different, and that's playing into part of what you see here. But I mean, I think the thing to keep in mind is that these institutions, whatever their criteria are, they are gatekeepers for people's futures, right? So whatever they're doing, I think we do need to think carefully about, well, what are the consequences? What are the consequences of this, you know, admissions regime, or whatever you want to call it? So I totally take your point, and I see, and I like that analogy to sort of think about, well, how does this work for, say, you know, doctoral, maybe it's akin to kind of doctoral admissions, but I think that, you know, I still think that, you know, having an under, if you look at the politicians in the UK, I think there was, like, almost half have some, you know, Oxford connection, and, you know, it provides resources, and it, you know, it can be a means for social mobility. So I think it's important to think about, you know, how it could not be like that. Mary, did you have that?
I want to sort of push on what I think I heard from Phil and the last two questions sort of collectively, which is, I think that in large, you seem to be centering, say, your causal hypothesis generating within the university. Whereas I think, sort of as Phil was pointing out, it's really, and as you yourself sort of gave us an account of it at the beginning, universities are embedded within cultures, within, you know, societies, within nations, and that the arguments that are, that the, what you found to be the sort of amazing similarity between, say, admissions officers and the students, I don't think necessarily bespeaks some kind of cultural imprinting from the admissions officers onto the student. Maybe that both are imprinted by the national context in which they live, right? And that in the United States, we live in this endless, of a certain sort, right, conversation about diversity and so forth, and in the UK, it's a different set of conversations, right? And so both may merely be reflective of a larger national culture. Similarly, I would say universities think of themselves very differently in terms of their role in the national context. You again referred to that briefly in the beginning, but this notion that, say, we know Oxbridge knows that the majority of their graduates are not going to go on to become scholars, and that they are going to go fill the halls of parliament and the halls of power, right? But interestingly, those are not the terms on which they evaluate students or overtly and explicitly train students, right? So they admit the student who's fantastic in mathematics, even though they know that most likely this person is going to go off and work for Barclays, say, right? And in the United States, you know, certainly at Harvard, everything we talk about is leadership, right? And preparing the leaders of tomorrow. And even, say, with respect to doctoral students, we don't necessarily talk about creating the scholars of tomorrow. We say, you know, we do. But there's very much this notion of the university has a responsibility toward the nation to provide, you know, the leaders. So I guess that seems to play into it a lot, is the notion of what the university's social role is and what the relationship is between the intellectual and the social.
Yeah, no, that's interesting to think about it like that in terms of the university's role in society. In terms of the imprinting, I think I am less inclined to agree with you there because, you know, in the kind of public debates or the kind of in the public eye, Oxbridge gets criticized all the time for being an elite institution, and that, you know, a lot of people don't see it as this place of you know, meritocracy and the best of the best. I think Harvard has more of that reputation in the United States, and you know, there's almost my sense is that there's, you know, among, say, working class people in the UK, there's sometimes a kind of disdain for those kind of elite institutions. So don't the students' views don't reflect any of that criticism or any of that sort of ambivalence, or, you know, it's almost like I'm here, I bought into it, or if I didn't buy into it, I wouldn't have, you know, those people aren't at the
university. To be really sure you're playing, you'd have to test or interview students who are in their sixth form in the final year, and to see
right.
whether they show the kind of diversity I think that Mira is anticipating before. you were assuming
that they wouldn't
you'd
be.
Get it even in the sixth form before they ever go to college.
Yes,
but
there
no,
is, but there are studies of kind of, you know, young, you know, working class students at
no, yeah, but that's not a fair comparison. We're talking about the student who might or might not be able to go to Oxford.
But doesn't go.
Well,
right.
No, because they've applied and they don't yet know. Your assumption is that when they get there, they'll be socialized or they're socialized.
No, I'm not necessarily saying that they're socialized at the university, although I think part of it is that. I think it happens before as well. Like, you know,
okay.
I think especially in the U.S., you know, through the guidance counselors and through, you know, what they're reading and learning about as they go through this process, this kind of admissions process. So it's, part of it is when they get there, but part of it is that time in their lives as well. But you know, in the U.K., not everyone is experiencing those things. I guess in the U.S. as well, right? Okay.
So I'm going to just add a couple things to this debate, but then I do have a real question.
Yeah.
So I think that you're pointing, you know, I would point to these institutional structures as being very important. And when, you know, Phil raised the question of why divergence, I think that the fact that there are these institutional structures in place when equality movements take off in both nations about how people are admitted into college and to university already in place, and the U.S. one can accommodate without radical change racial diversity into a system where you can both have it be explicit and deny it at the same time, and the British model can't. I think it's very important. And also, before those equality movements really take off in both nations, there is a long history of equality efforts or equalizing efforts. And those efforts had different institutions that they focused on before the movements really gained traction. And in Britain, it certainly was about secondary education divergence between academic and vocational tracking. And in the United States, college played a bigger role in those earlier movements. And so I think that it is somewhat, those institutional histories matter when the equality movements take off about where people continue to put a locus of where the mechanism of change would be. But
right.
Now here's my question. You talked about the interviews at Oxford, and I just had a kind of question about how many people are interviewed for each space. So what's the kind of selectivity after you meet the basic exam criterion? And also, are there any studies of how people with different backgrounds, particularly different school backgrounds, state schools, et cetera, how they fare through the interview process? So do we have any information to tell us whether, you know, 1 out of 10 people who are interviewed actually get slots, and that one is going to be more likely to have this kind of background?
Yeah. So in terms of the acceptance rates, I think it's like 20-something percent of students who apply are accepted, and about half who apply get interviewed. It varies by subject, so some are more competitive than others. So then you can do the math, right? So about half. I could be wrong about this.
40%.
Right, 50% of people who are interviewed get admitted, roughly.
Yeah.
are have a different level of cultural factor in it.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I can't remember the.
Thanks.
I mean, speaking informally, my sense was that in certain subjects, it was, quote, easier to use the purest notion. So in mathematics, they had an entrance exam, and they would simply rank order these students, and they would take the top whatever. In the case of the English literature exam, of course, you can't rank order in such an obvious way. So there was more room for cultural capital to enter in.
Yeah.
I think that's right.
There's actually a study of admissions tutors. And again, this is a small study, but they interviewed, the person interviewed a bunch of tutors. And they actually say, a lot of them say that they kind of informally give a leg up to state school graduates, so that if someone is coming from a state school, they sort of give them the benefit of the doubt a little bit more than or they have higher expectations. So people with the same, they have higher expectations of someone coming from a private school with the idea that you've had these opportunities. So that suggests
that they also know that the tutor knows that in these very elite schools, the students
they're getting
will be
coached,
trained and coached precisely for these Oxford interviews. So in some sense, I was trying to kind of balance that as an admissions tutor.
Yeah.
A few things that will actually merge into a single question. I do want to push back on the idea that the Constitution structures inequality this way, because it is a function of what the society was. Look at Harvard College being founded to educate English and Native American students, and how that actually didn't play out the way that we thought it would have. Based on what the original mission of the college was, that type of thinking was part of the discussion around in the Federalist Papers about how many people get to vote, who gets to vote, whether we're going to have a bicameral legislature, which types of legislatures are we going to have. That really is very informative about how our country shaped its future. My question, though, is how much of the diversity that we're talking about in the United States is a function of tokenism? And not a function of actually trying to diversify the population. It seems more like a mollification, saying that, okay, we had up until around 1945, before the end of the Second World War, there wasn't any massive structure about diversifying education in the United States, whether in private or in public schools. With women's liberation, the civil rights movement, Vietnam War, though that became unworkable for the country, but rather than having systemic wholesale change, what we did was say, we're going to adjust slightly. We're going to allow this person here and that person there, but not too many, just enough that, the classrooms look like they're truly diverse when they're not terribly representative. And that really hasn't changed, whether it's under a Bakke system of admissions, a Grutter, or even a Gratt system when that was still constitutional. And with the way that we've come out of the parents involved decision, which is our pipeline coming into colleges, I wonder how much of that is going to be reflected in the next generation of college students, especially given the sunset provision that Justice O'Connor had in Grutter, saying in 25 years we expect not to be able to use race in admissions.
Yeah.
So are we going to devolve back into a more explicitly token model of admissions? Because, I mean, just to be fair, how many of the students at Harvard and Brown were talking about athletes as tokens?
When you say token, can you say what
token?
I
mean
token.
I
mean, I kind of know the connotation, but maybe spell it out a little bit.
Token
more.
Being a representative from a particular group as opposed to having a critical mass, which is a number of people of different perspectives, having one person who has a phenotype or who fits a particular type of person that you're identifying as a diverse candidate. So, for example, having a black male or an Asian female. And saying that, this is going, we have diversified because we have included them. And we have not necessarily included them in any critical mass where you have true diversity among that population. It's not diversity for its own sake, it's diversity for the majority, as you pointed out in your last slide. So I wonder how much of our construct and our conversation about diversity is a function of this tokenism that stretches back even to the founding of this college.
So I actually think it's more, they're doing more than tokenism. There is a kind of critical. I mean, I think there is a critical mass of minority students at Harvard College. It's not representative of the country at all. But I think that problem is still there, right? And so you know, and it, the, I guess then the question is, what is our end goal, right? You know, to me, it says something that Black and Latino students are still underrepresented, and that's something that we should be concerned about, whether or not the classrooms are, you know, whether or not, I mean, it's, so I don't think it's tokenism. I think it's they've gone beyond that, but I think we still need to wonder what now or what next, or how do we sort of think about this or understand what's really going on here. I don't know if I answered your question or if it was, I don't know if you have anything to say about it.
We can talk about it. yeah, I have a lot to say about that.
I thought you were brilliant.
So good points. I mean, like, I'm really enjoying this. I wish we had more of these conversations in outside of class.
Come to CNEI.
Please, these are really good. So, I mean, grasping all the thoughts together, in terms of, because you have different approaches, when we say racism and these type of legacies are embedded within institutions, from a purely pragmatic view, where do you draw the line between understanding and recognizing that these institutions have these culturally and racially assigned stereotypes embedded within these institutions, and addressing this, combine that with using education as a tool to social mobility, versus the flip side, which is the tokenist approach, which is that Harvard will grasp at these certain diverse candidates and put them in a culture of assimilation rather than promoting diversity. And for example, when the conversations about whether they say, oh, it's very diverse, right? Now we can look in the room and we can see very different racial, cultural, whatever it may be. But if you go a few slides before that, the first slide, it says how many agree with disagree. It was 96% agree with this, 4% disagree. So how do you, for the pragmatic view, how do you deal with this notion of drawing the line and addressing racism within historical aspect of these universities, and actually finding a practical view to addressing tokenism?
So you just said a lot there. So I mean, I'm going to push back again on this idea that there is this sort of model of assimilation at these elite institutions in the United States. I actually think they do value diversity. They talk about it. I'm saying that everything is perfect by any, there are a lot of issues and problems, but I think that as institutions, they do care about having a diverse student body, diverse perspectives, and that they do value that. I'm gonna take that stand and say that, defend them in that way. But if they're not using admissions as an, then you sort of suggested it being an equalizer. I don't think the students aren't saying that, and I don't think the admissions office didn't say it either, that this is a form of, promoting social equality. I think one could make that argument, and one could say that, but they don't. And that's true of the universities, and it's true of the students. I mean, part of it might be the legal context in which you can't, legally you can't really say that, I'm using affirmative action to reduce inequality in society. That's not a legally sound argument. The only kind of legal criterion that's been successful in court has been this diversity criteria, and that might be driving all of this in a way in the United States. So
I'm going to call us to a close here,
yeah,
and say that before I thank Natasha and Phil, I know that after our last CMEI colloquium, where Hunter Gelbach spoke about perspective taking and other issues, that there was actually, I think, a discussion group that was formed and and so I want to encourage you, if you want to have more conversations like these, please feel free to follow up on this topic in particular, to